During the build-up to and the launch of the Second Amendment to the 18th edition, we all got very caught up in the storm of controversy surrounding the increased use of AFDDs, and it's possible that we overlooked some of the other key changes regarding circuit protection, including the changes that took place to the requirements for RCDs. So what changes did happen with RCDs in the latest amendment to the wiring regs? Well, the first major change that we want to discuss relates to the ongoing decline of the type AC RCD. Regulation 531.3.3 discusses the different flavours of RCD protection, which we're becoming more familiar with now, these being types AC, A, F and B. The main differences between these is how they monitor and deal with DC leakage into their electrical system. To understand why DC leakage is a problem, let's look in a little more depth as to how an RCD operates. Now, we've got a diagram here of a traditional RCD, what's referred to as an AC type RCD, which is the basic RCD that we've mostly been installing for years and years. Inside the RCD, the line conductor wraps around this toroidal or ring-shaped piece of soft iron. It then goes off and feeds the load. The neutral from the load then returns and wraps around the other side of the toroidal core and returns to the source of supply. Now, at the same time, wrapped around the core, there's this third coil that feeds a tripping device that connects to the switching contacts in the line and neutral connections. Now, when the circuit is healthy, the current passes through the line and the same amount of current comes back down the neutral. As the current passes through the coil around the core, it generates a magnetic field around the coil. But because the same amount of current is passing through the neutral coil at the bottom, a magnetic field is created around this coil that is equal but has an opposite direction to the magnetic field around the line conductor. The upshot of this is that the two fields cancel each other out. Now, if an earth fault occurs and the current flowing back through the neutral is slightly smaller, this makes the neutral magnetic field slightly weaker than the one around the line conductor. So now this slightly stronger magnetic field is able to generate a small amount of current into the tripping coil using the exact same principles as the operation of a transformer. If the difference in current in the line and neutral is big enough, the current generated in the tripping coil will be enough to trigger the tripping device and disconnect the circuit. I'm sure you'll agree this is an elegant and ingenious piece of design, and if the electricity running through it is a purely AC supply, then it will operate exquisitely. However, modern loads that we connect to our circuits, such as washing machines, dishwashers, IT and entertainment equipment, all leak DC back into the AC system. We can illustrate this using this lovely graphing software from Desmos. Here we have a healthy AC waveform, and here we can see what a DC waveform looks like, just a straight flat waveform. Now, the problem occurs when we combine the two by leaking DC back into the AC supply, because as the DC combines with this AC waveform, you can see it lifts the whole AC waveform up the y-axis. Now, just a word of caution for our understanding here, the subsequent lower waveform down at the bottom here does not indicate that there is less current in the neutral than the line. If this was true, the device would trip. When the AC waveform drops below zero into the negative range, it indicates that the current has changed direction. So now, when the current is going one way around the circuit, it is slightly higher than when it reverses and goes the other way. This has the effect of slightly magnetising the magnetic core in one direction, leaving a slight magnetic field in there all the time. Now, if an earth fault occurs, the magnetic field around the neutral is slightly weaker, but because there is a weak permanent magnetic field inside the soft iron core, there isn't enough strength in the imbalanced field to overcome that slight remaining magnetism and generate enough current in the tripping coil to disconnect the circuit. So the device simply won't trip. Now, for the more mature members of our audience, you may remember the old Robin testers that featured the D-lock function. This allowed the tester to carry out an earth fault loop impedance test on circuits that were protected by RCDs, and it worked in the exact same way. It would inject DC current into the circuit and stun the RCD by saturating it magnetically, meaning the impedance test could then be carried out without tripping the RCD. Now, that's all very interesting, but what are the real-life implications of this? Well, if our installations connect the loads we discussed earlier in the video, then it's likely that our old AC type RCDs won't operate under fault conditions, meaning that someone could be receiving a lethal amount of electricity and the RCD simply won't disconnect the circuit. So it seems with all the DC leaky loads people are connecting to our electrical installations, the type AC RCD is a thing of the past, and it seems the Second Amendment is reinforcing this idea. After defining the different types of RCD, Regulation 531.3.3 states, RCD type AC shall only be used to serve fixed equipment where it is known that the load current contains no DC components. Note 1 just below adds further insight as to just what an AC type RCD can be used on, where it says examples of fixed equipment with a load current containing no DC components can include, but not be limited to, electric heating appliances and or simple filament lighting, neither containing electronic components. As you can imagine, in this day and age where the simplest heater may well incorporate digital controls or lighting will be based on LEDs, it seems that the type AC RCD may well be breathing its last, and the base level of RCD protection will be the type A moving forward. If you'd like to know how Amendment 2 has affected the use of RCDs in split load consumer units, please watch this video here, and for a full breakdown of the changes Amendment 2 made to circuit protection, check out our free training package by clicking the link in the description below. Thank you very much for watching.